Your introduction. Does it start automatically or do I have to press any button? Cool. So thank you so much for coming here to this presentation of the artistic use of virtual reality. My name is Tina Sauerländer and my main topics today will be these four: the history of immersion, just briefly because you already had a presentation on this, the history of the development of virtual reality, and the history of virtual reality in art, and then the main point, today's artistic use of VR. To start with the history of immersion, I have to tell you that immersion is not a new thing, actually. Humankind always was interested in this, in diving into the other worlds, steeping into other worlds, also like, for example, the Egyptian chambers, or also Romanesque churches in the Middle Ages, which you, if you visit them nowadays, most of them have lost all the paintings. They are just stone, but usually they were colored or painted like this, a very rare example in Germany at the Reichenau. Or then also the invention of the central perspective in the Renaissance. Like, this is a kind of like example on how people or humankind wanted to become immersed or dive into another world. Because, yeah, if you stand in front of this in Florence, in Santa Maria Novella, you will have the feeling that there is a space opening up behind Christ, actually. And also the painted architecture, the trompe-l'œil architecture, refers to the real one. Another example, which I like very much. And then one of my favorites, a really huge painting by Paolo Veronese, which is in Venice, and it's 12 by 5 meters. So obviously when you stand in front of it, you can see like the sides and you will have the feeling of immersion. And here you also see clearly how the real architecture relates to the painted one. So now we jump a bit to like nowadays. As you can see here, it's an IMAX cinema where people sit in their chairs with the, I think, 3D glasses on and watching a movie, which is like a very contemporary example of how people want to become immersed and how today illusionary spaces are created. But still, there you're in it with your body, you see your neighbor, you feel your seat. You are not alone as you are in virtual reality. The history of the development of virtual reality is the history of developing HMDs, which serve as a means to fully dive into another world. Like, the first ones are the stereoscopes, invented parallel to photography in the 19th century. And yeah, you know, you have two different images or the same image slightly viewing from a different angle with your two eyes, and then they overlay in your perception and you have the feeling of 3D. Also, like the wonderful ViewMaster serves the same idea, or this stereoscope, which was used in the former GDR. Or nowadays, you can use the stereo granimator of the New York Public Library and use their images, or use your own to create your 3D GIFs, or create samples to use it with your stereoscope. So, 1960, things changed. Morgan Hillig created a telesphere mask with two screens in it so that you could basically view 3D television. So the images began to move and to, became three-dimensional in front of your eyes. Same here, the Sword of Damocles by Evan Sutherland. Yeah, that's a really big thing, which is because this is the first HMD head-mounted display which was connected to a computer, and actually also an augmented reality display because you could see through the lenses. Yeah, and with the computer, basically all the resources of technology went into like creating the computer. So VR kind of stopped more or less for several years. And so we jumped to the 80s, to the, it's no joke, right? It's the iPhone. which cost $9,400 in the 80s and was mainly used also for arcade gaming or so. So there was virtual reality, but it was really, really expensive. So it wasn't like able to enter the mass market. Also, Sega, for example, wanted to release this headset for the mass market, which just wasn't like, it just didn't function. It wasn't like ready for the mass market. They just used it for arcade gaming also. Yeah, and 2 years later, Nintendo indeed released the VR headset for the mass market, the Nintendo Virtual Boy. And yeah, as you can see, the graphics kind of really suck actually, and people got nausea from using it. So this thing totally flopped. The technology was just not ready to be used in a broader sense as we know today. The history of virtual reality in art also starts in the late 80s or 90s. And an example by Jeffrey Shore, one of the pioneers in this field, with his interactive art installation. And so in the 90s, the idea of interactivity was really, really important in this field. You will see all the examples now deal with interactivity. And you also need to know that virtual reality was kind of a different, was differently connotated in the 90s, because it also meant that you sat in front of a huge screen, which gives you the feeling of immersion, and then you could use the work or interact with the work with a joystick or like here, sitting on a bike and running through the city. And yeah, the legible city is a city where you can read all kinds of information about the city you're going through. And Jeffrey Shore did this for Manhattan, for Stuttgart and Karlsruhe. He also worked at ZKM. He was a founding director of the Institute for Image Science or so, somehow like this it is called. Or also Michael Neimark, he was at ZKM and inventing the Karlsruhe movie map, where you could do a tram ride through the city, basically in a virtual reality, if you want so. One of the big pioneers in this field, you really need to remember her name, Char Davis. She was one of the few people who really worked with VR headsets in the 90s, and it was really, really expensive, so also not everyone could afford it, and she was one of the few doing this work, Osmose in 1995, or also this one, Ephemer, in 1998, dealing with the body, the perception of the body, and nature in general. And also this thing, the cave, used the term virtual reality. The cave is called Automatic Virtual Reality Environment, which was invented in 1992. And it was basically just a 3x3 meter cube with projection walls. So you stood inside this cube, 3x3 meters, and you had projections everywhere. And this was called also like virtual reality, or like the holodeck maybe on in Star Trek, Star Wars, I don't know. So, this cave was widely used also in for production design in the automotive industry, so it was not an art-related thing, but also artists discovered it. And like this example by David Pape or Jeffrey Shaw also used the cave for his installations, or Peter Kogler, an Austrian artist, used the one for Ars Electronica in Linz, who bought one cave. And yeah, why artists use virtual reality? As you can see here, Peter Kogler already did like 3 years before, 4 years before, he was dealing with how space or architecture can be changed by giving it a new surface, basically. Here, he used silkscreen prints to cover the whole room. And yeah, before that, or like after that in the cave, he could even use moving images covering the space and creating a new space via the projections. And I will skip this, another installation about like being surrounded, being immersed, and being able to interact with the people outside in a nearby park. And yeah, Tamiko Thiel, here you see how it worked actually. You had a big screen or projection which covered one wall, and the works had been screened there, and you could like interact with them with a joystick. here are some more visuals of her work, Beyond Manzana, which is about the relations between Japan and the US and the Second World War and an internment camp called Manzana. Yeah, and then before all the technological inventions happened, there had also been VR shows like this one in 2010, just to tell you that VR was there all the time, kind of, even if we didn't recognize it so much. Yeah, and that's my main point, actually. Today's artistic use of virtual reality. And, you know, last year, last 1.5 years, many things happened. So the headsets doesn't cost like $9,000 anymore, but maybe 900 euros for the Vive, 700 for the Oculus, 100 for the Zeiss VR1. Or you can even go to Woolworth and buy a headset for 5 euro, the VR box, which is even cheaper than the Google Cardboard for 10 euros. And yeah, I will now introduce different exhibitions that happened in VR in the past month or maybe years even. So this is the exhibition Nausea, and it was made or curated by Philipp Hausmeier, who owns Metaphysics VR, and he programs VR works for artists who use VR for the first time, actually. So he was invited by HTC Vive to do this show, Nausea, last year, featuring these artists. Here some visuals, Eddie Peake oder Anna KI. It's also a really nice installation where you jump between the different layers and levels. Yeah, and what Philip did, because his whole show, it just happened in VR, you had the headset all the time, you stood there with the Vive, and then you, when you start, you stand in the middle of a like empty space with the artist names floating around, and you open up the portals to the different artworks with this movement with your HTC Vive controllers. Then there's also VR, web VR, which can be used via with your cardboards at home, and is released with an app. For example, this one here, the First Look Artists VR app from the New Museum at Rhizom in New York, that was released in February 2017. And yeah, when you open the app, it looks like this, and you could choose the artwork you want to see, click on it, and then download it or stream it. One example is this, Rachel Rosen's man mask for First Look. Then another big thing when it comes to art and virtual reality is Alfredo Salazar-Caro's Digital Museum of Digital Art, which premiered already in December 2015 at Transfer Gallery in New York. And this is really a museum, you know, you can, you stand in front of the building, you wear your Oculus, and then you can go, yeah, that's the outside, you can then go inside with your controllers, you move around, and then you walk up the stairs to see the artworks that are presented then in this museum. So it's always like 4 artworks presented. For example, this one by Jacoby Satterwhite, who already did work for the New Museums VR app, which you can download in the App Store, or Claudia Hart, also for Demoda for the first edition. And then we have Unreal. This show will open on May 24th in Düsseldorf at NRW Forum. And Manuel Rosner, he created a new space, a virtual space for the museum. So that's a space, basically. So you see the real-life building, and then when you enter the real-life building to the top floor, you put on the headset, and from there on, you will be able to climb up in this new building, which only exists in VR, and then you will see also there different VR artworks like this one by Akihiko Taniguchi or Theo Triantafylidis. So visit the NRW forum from May 24th on. It will be really worth it, and they will also host a big conference on virtual reality and art. Yeah, now I want to take the chance to talk about the exhibition I curated, The Unframed World, Virtual Reality as Artistic Medium for the 21st Century. So it took place at HEC, House of Electronic Arts in Basel this year, and featured nine international artists. And so all the other VR shows I introduced you to before, they all took place basically only, well, they all took place only in VR or in the digital realm. So for this show, The Unframed World, I created a virtual reality exhibition in a physical exhibition space. Which was really exciting, because the idea was that VR is a new tool for all of us, or the digital realms are actually new to us all, and we always speak from about the real world and a virtual world, and they just like slowly merge together. So, and many generations totally like feel the difference, or today you still feel the difference. So I decided to do a show that relates both worlds, that they have a real exhibition and a real space combined with virtual reality works, and both sides talk to each other, interfere with each other, or you can see things that you can in real life, can do in real life, but not in virtual reality, or mostly the other way around. So this is the entrance. We showed, because I showed VR works before, and I experienced that many people are still a bit hesitant to use it, because you really have to be active to use the headset. And so we showed a video introducing VR as a technology to create some like really interest, that people enter the show then and really want to see the VR works and try it. So, but when you enter the space, you just walk. You just see this work at first, which is a UV map of a hand, but this time not digitally, but in real life, 2 meters by 1.50 meters, and perfectly shaped and colored, so it totally looks like a real hand. And so you have the idea of the digital then transferred to the real world. And so this hand, basically, for me, it symbolizes a lot about the exhibition. The first thing is that you have to do, that you really have to be active. You know, you just can't like look at things. You really have to try on the glasses and then walk around and look everywhere. So it's not like you go to a usual museum and there's just a sculpture or the painting on the wall. You really have to be active. And one special thing about VR is that you don't have any narration anymore, so you can decide where you go by yourself. When you have the headset on, you decide, I look left, I look right, I look up. And that's the same for the show. There is no like path or so. When you enter, you see the hands, and then you have to decide where you go. It's your decision. And there you see the work by Rachel Rossen. You can see that she paints these abstract paintings deriving from patterns she finds in her like closer surroundings. And there is this physical version of these of the patterns, these paintings, with the projection on it. And in VR, you would see and do the following. So you again see the fabric floating around, and you are basically trying to grasp it all the time, which is not possible. So you can do this senseless occupation in this beautiful surroundings kind of forever, if you want to. Yeah, now back to the hands, the work by Melodie Mosset and Naem Baron. Here you can grow hands. You're in this like desert-like place where you can grow hands with your controllers. Yeah, and you can also grow them like in the sky, endlessly in the sky, and you can also jump on these hands. So you also got lots of different associations about like the Tower of Babel is one big association I have, at least, or like being connected with each other, like individuals being connected in a society, like if you have this chain of hands. Or for the artist, it's mainly about reproduction. Actually, she compares the human reproduction system to the virtual one, where actually no original exists in both, and therefore the idea of uniqueness is totally unimportant at all in both worlds, actually. Yeah, Alfredo Sala Saccaro, I will show you the video first, maybe. I mean, I would. Yeah, so Alfredo used VR to create a new way of a portrait of a person. You know, when you just paint a portrait, you will just have one view of this person. And Alfredo created this lush garden in VR where you could move around and see different versions of the same person. And as you see this last one here, this distorted sculpture, when you're in VR, it's right next to you and it's like this big and it floats and it turns around all the time. And this, of course, you can't do in real life. And that's why we... No. Why we had in the exhibition space this small sculpture, this white sculpture next to his work, so that you can definitely see what's the difference between doing sculpture in VR and doing it in real life. It also looks great in real life, but in VR you have so much more possibilities, obviously. You can be in the same space with the floating sculpture without any screen separating you from the sculpture, and that's a very great experience and a great tool. Especially, yeah, also for artists. And yeah, the Düsseldorfers Banz and Bowinkel, they created another planet, basically, which resembles ours, but then totally changes in physical laws are not applicable anymore. And yeah, Rendon Johnson, he's an American artist. He did a poem for VR, and it was really important for him that you have really the feeling of immersion. And as you see, as you can see, he uses web VR, so you can download his file from YouTube or watch it with your cardboard at home from YouTube. I will just show you also a quick sequence.
Fucking in Venice. I fucked this dancer in Venice, buck naked on a canal. She said the sex was so good, she'd marry me if I was rich. I told her I was rich. Sorry, she said. She meant she'd marry me if I wasn't black. I fucked her from behind after that.
Yeah, you can hear he talks about really crucial issues of our time or our personal life, sex, love, and gender. It's really great work. It's definitely worth seeing it. So that's, it's a very complex work, Martha Hipley, but what you can see here is that she customized these Google Cardboards, five pieces, because you can actually see your perfect boyfriend with them. And the add-ons were meant to be the physical expression of what you see in VR. So these devices are made of silicone, they heat up, they vibrate, and they also light up. And then you can... see and feel your perfect boyfriend through VR, actually. And yeah, it's a very complex work. She criticizes a lot, for example, the online the tests in girls' magazines, teenage girls' magazines, that tell you what type of whatever you are or what's the perfect boyfriend for you. And so first thing you do is taking this online test, answering really absurd questions to then get your result of your perfect boyfriend. For example, this cute guy here. Fragmentine, it's also relates also between the real and the virtual. In the virtual world, wearing the glasses, you see the others moving with you around, and the people who visit the show, they saw you like sitting on these rotating chairs doing different choreographies in the actual exhibition space. That's Mark Lee.
Ja, wir finden.
Yeah, again, why artists use virtual reality. So for Magli, he created in VR like this, no, let's start differently. So Magli once created an artwork which was shown on huge cubes in real life. So he had an exhibition space, then he built like similar cubes, white cubes very high, and then projected his social media images that he collected on these via projection in the real exhibition space. And this is, of course, really a huge effort to do this, to build like big cubes, to have lots of projectors projecting on it. And for Mark Lee, VR was the chance to actually transfer his whole installation into VR, to have the chance to build even higher cubes that he could not build in real life, to really create the sense of skyscrapers, and to project much more images from the internet on his cubes, so that you can walk through the different cities in VR, which are projected on the towers, and you really feel, of course, again, the dimensions of them, because you don't have this frame anymore. Then we have this wonderful installation by Lia Lin, who is also here, and she will be on stage in a few minutes, right after me, talking about her work. And this one I presented in Basel and Heck. And just briefly, I won't tell too much. So when you enter the exhibition space, the physical exhibition space, you will find a circle of chairs, which are more or less empty. You just find different devices laying on the chairs. And yeah, when you enter the VR, you will see 7 clone characters of Dina that will talk to you about the reproduction system.
We are here today to heal, protect, and evolve the reproductive system of the Earth. The situation is catastrophic. The Earth has fever. The cells are in atrophy.
Yes, that's all I will say about this, and Lee will continue in a few minutes. Yeah, a wrap-up maybe in the end. Why artists use virtual reality, as you saw, the wish for immersion is not a new thing. It's kind of inherited into humankind. But and with VR, it's the first time, actually, that you are fully immersed. And I know you don't have your body with you yet, but this will also change in the next years. And yeah, you have a 360 view. You don't have any frames anymore, which really connects you so much more to the digital world than before, and therefore you also have a different way of narrating stories or telling stories. It's not like in a cinema where you watch one perspective on one screen. It's much more complex now, and you can do many more interesting things with VR and art now. And then, of course, really, really important is that your body, that you in VR relate to the dimensions of the whole space, and that makes you feel the dimensions like you feel them in the real world, too. And therefore, I told you about Alfredo and the sculpture floating around, turning around. You have much more possibilities in VR than you have IRL. And yeah, I'm in the same space with the artwork, and that's a pretty great experience. Yeah, and then what I like very much about virtual reality personally is that this device you use, like if it's whatever, Vive, Oculus, Cardboard, it's usable for many other experiences you can have in your daily life, like kind of watching movies, watching porn, or having touristical experiences, all kinds of stuff, and VR can be part of it, or VR art can be part of it, which means that this kind of art is not made of materials you never use in daily life, like oil painting or marble. Who uses that in daily life? No one. But these devices you will use in daily life, in your living room, for many other things. And so that's, for me personally as a curator, the chance that art can be back in the homes of everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina. I was wondering where we could see all these beautiful installations in the future.
Yeah, there are documentations online. I can also give links on the VR app of New Museum. You can, for example, download And I myself will be doing a huge show on virtual reality opening on September 8th at Prisca Pascal in Cologne.
In Cologne. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.